So for me, it raises a question of administrative justice or possibly injustice if you don't happen to have a good enough teacher to pitch correctly. And there's currently a discussion going on in South Africa around that. Also, the statistical moderation using allowing SBA tasks to external examination, if you're using a whole range of assessment tasks that don't relate to the exam, is that an appropriate mechanism? I think it probably depends on how much you have of the alternative. So where are we? The current assessment demands are probably not being carried out in an acceptable standard in a number of schools. It's causing administrative overload on teachers and may be repetitive and unhelpful for learners. So that's kind of this message that seems to be coming through. We do have the counter of that. If SBA is not part of the final result, then there's no guarantee that teachers will actually do any school-based assessment or class-based assessment for learning, because there's no longer an imperative, there's no one checking on them. And if you've got limited experience, you're certainly not going to go and do something that makes you uncomfortable. So there's a dilemma. On the one hand, it's a stick, and one would probably want to make it a carrot, so that you don't have this resistance to school-based assessment. So what can we do? We can abandon it. I have a question mark over that. I think school-based assessment within the schooling sector has a very useful role to play, unlike in our adult sector. Perhaps we could use it more effectively and make the effort to get it right worthwhile. Make it a carrot. Draw teachers into it so that they become more motivated to get it right. So what can we do? I think there's a couple of things we can do. They're not earth-shattering, but I think they could become much more upfront in the South African system. Using monitoring reports to identify teachers who are on track and those who need assistance. One of our colleagues used the term off the shelf, which I thought was quite interesting. In other words, you keep all the school-based assessment results on the shelf, and if a school is not doing too well, they're starting to fall off the shelf, so you pick them up and fix them. So you put in an intervention to improve the capacity of the teachers who need upgrading of subject knowledge and pedagogical content knowledge. And I think this is an area possibly where in South Africa our interventions have stalled. There's been a lot of work done on upgrading the subject content, but not necessarily the capacity to teach within a subject. And then relieve those who are on track of the additional administration required by the moderation process. So if you're doing it right, we leave you alone. We don't worry about you until you show a sign of perhaps moving offline. We could also make greater use of the SBA results that are compliant and reliable, which you can pick up. If a learner is assessed in SBA at a specific level and in the final exam achieves a borderline score, give the learner the benefit. So if after the whole process a learner ends up, for example, on 79 or 49 or whatever, if in their school-based assessment they were at the higher level, at an 81 or a 52 or whatever the case may be, then give them the benefit of the doubt so that that SBA is actually countering a borderline score. If a learner misses a final examination for legitimate reasons, at the moment they would have to write a supplementary exam 3 months later, and you've got all that stress of delay and trying to pick up energy at the time. If you've got a reliable set of school-based assessments, you can use that to pitch the learner at a particular point. In other words, giving more credibility to the SBA and hence an imperative to get it right. I think there's a lot more sort of philosophical questions that underpin the notion of using SBA, which is essentially assessment for learning, within a certification context. Can assessment for learning ever be effectively used in assessment for certification? I think that's a debatable point. Is it appropriate to use a one-size-fits-all in the use of SBA when the discrepancies across the system are vast? It's a moral question. Can assessment for certification ever be completely fair? I mean, that goes right to the heart of exams at a set time. We can only do our best to limit the negative impacts. And is that good enough? I don't know. So, Thank you.
Oh, I hope so, anyway. In Queensland, our senior secondary teachers are actually responsible for designing assessment programs and making judgments about the standards achieved by their students. Their judgments are based on evidence that must stand up to external scrutiny. Queensland's moderation process, supported by the professional training that is provided by the Queensland Studies Authority, QSA, enhances teachers' capacity to make comparable judgments about the quality of student work. From 2014, an Australian curriculum in senior secondary English, mathematics, science and history will be introduced, with content outlined and achievement standards described in terms of the qualities of learning expected each year. Queensland senior secondary teachers already have some experience in this and will be looking for evidence and folios of student work against standard descriptors over 5 levels of achievement to make their judgments about their student achievement. This presentation will actually examine the relationship between the theory that has informed external moderated school-based assessment in Queensland and the practical application of this in the development of classroom assessment practices for an Australian curriculum across P-12. Just to give you a little bit of a timeline of what we're looking at, in May 2009, the Australian Curriculum Assessment and Reporting Authority, known as ACARA, an independent statutory authority, took over the work of the National Curriculum Board, or what was known as the NCB. The NCB had been established in February 2008 to develop the core content and achievement standards in mathematics, science, history and English from kindergarten to year 12, with a national curriculum to be available, they did say 2010, but now we're looking at draft versions of it this year. That was only what is known as phase one. It's phase two and phase three, and they're some years off in terms of what we're going to be seeing there. But the ACARA's work in developing this Australian curriculum is guided by this document known as the Melbourne Declaration. The Melbourne Declaration for Educational Goals for Young Australians. And that declaration, quote, to supporting all young Australians to become successful learners in confident and creative individuals and active and informed citizens, and to promoting equity and excellence in education. It is believed or hoped that the Australian curriculum will equip all young Australians with the essential skills, knowledge and capabilities to thrive and compete in a globalised world and information-rich workplaces in the current century. The national curriculum will be accessible to all young Australians, regardless of their social or economic background or the school that they attend. Now, up until 2007, the 6 states and the 2 territories in Australia developed individual approaches to the use of standards, as well as the implementation of their curriculum. Changes began with the NCB and followed with ACARA, informing these papers and a whole lot of processes of how we're going to consult on this national curriculum, looking particularly at standards as well. Now, ACARA will have the responsibility for the management and the implementation of the Australian curriculum and national student assessment and reporting of school education outcomes, the reporting of that. A major aim is to establish a standards reference framework to invigorate a national effort to improve student learning in selected subjects. That was a quote from the NCB in 2008. Yet there's been very little discussion or debate or articulation about the curriculum and its relationship with the achievement standards. What has been missing from the public debate is the relationship with the achievement, what has been missing is the identification of the assessment evidence that is to be used to inform the development and the employment of these achievement standards. To date, there's been very little information about how national achievement standards will be developed and how they will be used in practice. There are numerous meanings of the word standards in educational literature. The achievement standards in the draft Australian curriculum K-10, because we've yet to see the standards in year 11 and 12, can be understood as progressive targets or milestones. While successfully articulating a framework for growth and development, these achievement standards at this stage will provide little assistance to teachers when they have to use them to judge the quality of student achievement and reporting the achievements on the A-to-E scale. It has been agreed nationally that at each level for K to 10, teachers are required to report these student achievements to parents using an A-to-E framework. ACARA will develop brief descriptions for each of these five reporting levels. These descriptors will be generic across each year level and learning areas, and they'll provide a consistent language to describe the qualities of achievement associated with each A-to-E grade group uses from K to 10. Now, at this stage, what we're seeing is these standards are aligned with a C standard. And the D level on the reporting framework will describe a quality of learning that is adequate for progression, but may indicate that the student will need additional support or assistance in progressing within the next level. Additional work samples which illustrate achievement well above and well below this achievement standard will be provided to teachers to assist them to make on-balance judgments at the A, B, D and E standards of achievement. We're being told that this is what will happen. We have yet to see this. From a review of literature related to standards, it is apparent that a set of standards should represent consensus among stakeholders on what students must know and be able to do. The closer the alignment between standards and assessment, between standards and teaching, and between standards and curriculum, and between teaching and assessment, the better the student achieves. Therefore, it is anticipated that the QSA will need to provide advice to teachers in Queensland to assist them to recognise these standards from A to E and identify levels of achievement. Advice will be required to assist teachers to monitor and also to provide feedback to students about what they need to focus on in order to achieve as best they can. And this is the context in which we find ourselves in the Queensland system at this stage in 2010. I'd just like to take you back though in terms of the context of the Queensland system, a bit of a history lesson of where we're at and how we might be a little bit at odds with what's going to happen at a national system. Okay. In 1972, the Queensland system of school-based assessment at 4 years 11 and 12 was introduced based on recommendations for schooling from what was known as the Radford Report. And at this stage, I'd like to acknowledge John Pittman, who probably has had a lot to do with this system. So welcome, John. Thank you for attending my presentation. But John probably could give you a vast history of all of this, the ins and outs of it. It was based on the recommendations from the Radford Report. And for the first time, assessment instruments devised by teachers and their judgments that they've made about how well students have learned became the major component of the final results for certification. It was the end of a one-off external examination and the beginning of high-stakes conversations between teachers. These conversations are commonly known as moderation, a process for producing consistency across assessors in qualitative judgments of student performance or achievement. Moderation contributes to quality assurance of assessment procedures and outcomes. That's from Maxwell. Over the last, so we see in 1972, that is introduced. Over the last 40 years, Queensland has continued to review and revise the moderation system. In particular, in the 1980s, the system moved from a norm-based model to a criteria-based model, assessing student achievement. And in 1990, we saw what was known as the Viviani Report, which looked at the recommendations of the system to investigate determining the comparability of assessment outcomes across schools in Queensland. So since the 1970s, Queensland students in their final 2 years of schooling have been taught and assessed by teachers who operate within a system of rigorous checks and balances to ensure fair and accurate outcomes. We've found no need in the last 40 years for high-stake public exams. Our system is unique within Australia and possibly within the world in terms of it relies entirely, 100%, on school-based assessment. It's a system in which teachers are responsible for the assessment of student achievement using standard descriptors, in making the judgments about student work against these standards, and we have review panels of trained teachers that undertake the external moderation. We're talking about approximately 4,500 teachers that we train in the system. Moderation practices occur in terms of the system of externally moderated school-based assessment in senior schooling, and the Queensland Curriculum Assessment and Reporting Initiative, which has introduced standards reference moderation in years 1 to 9. While the details of these two approaches differ, what is common to them is that the system ensures that teachers reach judgments with high validity and high reliability. The system also is based on consensus moderation or social moderation, where groups of trained teacher reviewers meet formally to ensure the quality of assessment instruments and ensure the judgments of standards are comparable from school to school, a process of independent reviewing and also evidence-based decision-making and consensus based on professional conversations and negotiations. It is important that the essential ingredients for any effective system, whether it be local and local, such as the Queensland system, and a national system, or even internationally, as suggested yesterday in some of the presentations today, that the dot points on this PowerPoint are there. That's the sort of thing that we'll be looking for in a national curriculum. And recent studies have confirmed internationally the importance of social moderation in any assessment regime, to ensure comparable outcomes and improve teacher assessment capabilities. Maxwell argues that there are at least 4 different usages of the meaning of the term standards in relation to educational assessment and reporting. I've outlined those 4 there on the slide. What we're seeing in some of the conversation and the documentation at the Australian curriculum level is really what we might call performance standards. It's not clear from the ACARA documentation whether these are the same as or different from achievement standards. And in terms of human resource context, performance standards tend to describe behaviour that is acceptable for the carrying out of certain duties. And using word derivation then, it would seem evident that these achievement standards can be linked to achieving of intended outcomes or objectives. Performance standards then suggest that students have carried out some activity that we want to describe how well they've carried out this defined activity. In Queensland, the 4th usage of the use of the word term standards has been adopted. We see standards as an arbiter of quality, and the QSA's P-12 assessment policy describes achievement standards in the following way. That important part, the description of achievement standards, are derived by groups of teachers and subject experts describing actual differences in examples of student work, is vital for them to be useful for teachers to be able to use. As I've said, our system, from probably years one, and not so much primary, prep or kindy, but years 1 to 12 is standards-based now in Queensland. And this means, particularly in years 11 and 12, that the judgments about the quality of the student achievement are made with reference to predefined standards that describe how well students have achieved the objectives and the syllabuses. And those predefined standards ensure that students and teachers know what is expected, that it's comparable from school to school, that can be achieved, and that teachers can discuss these standards with parents and carers when reporting on student achievement, that those conversations can. It has been argued that teachers need the freedom to make definitive evidence-based judgments on their student work according to established standards and a quality framework that guarantees a dependable or teacher-led assessment. Consistency in the matching of standards is more likely if those standards are explicitly stated and exemplified. Clarifications of the standards is the key activity in moderation. However, no matter how appropriate the standard statements and exemplars are, assessors, teachers, can and will interpret them differently. Moderation is directed at aligning those assessors' different understandings and judgments of the relevant standards to produce a shared interpretation and shared meaning. Meaning is not transparent, rather it must be constructive. The words used in the statements of a standard denote the standard. That is, it attempts to convey the meaning of the standard. Whether the same meaning is derived by each assessor is problematic, and thus the foundation for any moderation system needs to be based on discussion amongst assessors. These discussions need to occur before, during, and after assessment. They also need to be ongoing, and such discussions need to start with some of the statements of standards, criteria for representing those standards, and any available exemplars. Recent research on the design of the moderation system and makes extensive use of conversations between panellists that is highly brain compatible and develops expertise is likely to have wide applicability. Accurate judgments by assessors are critical in quality assuring processes. The moderation system in Queensland provides that opportunity for teachers and panellists to have those conversations that is aligned with subject standard descriptors. And according to Purnell and Dudley, the clarity of purpose in moderation panel meetings is brain compatible. Our brains like to know what they should pay attention to and what they should ignore or purposefully filter out. We provide professional training of our teachers in supporting them by using exemplar student work. These exemplars are used to represent the standards, both from 8E, but particularly we focus on A and C. And we provide the capacity to illustrate these in different ways to satisfy the requirements of those standards. The use of such exemplars can have an important effect on teaching and student learning, and in turn using standards to draw on feedback to student improvement. Sadler argued, for example, that exemplars of samples of student work provide concrete references for illustrating standards that otherwise remain abstract mental constructs. In any system, whether it be our current system, our teachers will be looking for the sort of support materials that we already have to provide them with an understanding of what these standards might look like in various levels of achievement. We provide on our open website for years 11 and 12 annotated instruments, annotated student responses, and assessment instruments highlighting the standard matrix and other supported material. In our years 1 to 9, we have what's known as an assessment bank, which does the same thing in annotating student responses, assessment instruments, and highlighting the standard matrix. This supports the teachers and students in lending weight to what Max will refer to as frames of reference, that these are important for a common interpretation and understanding if we're going to have national, what some teachers are talking about, national consistency. Sadler referred to this as guild knowledge. It's fundamental in building a knowledge about skills, about assessment, and establishing this guild knowledge of criteria and standards. And it's important to have all of this support material, such as both PD, professional development, and the material we have on our website. It's also important to include students, and Sadler referred to this as letting students into the secret. It's important that students know about the standards and understand them with their teachers and have that conversation. And finally, as Australia moves towards the implementation of the Australian curriculum, our teachers and our students will be looking towards the national curriculum to ensure that they are able to provide them with those sort of standards that are both useful for teachers and students in what they've currently been, what they're currently used to. Thank you.
Just a sort of a question to Anne. I mean, I think that the problem is a bit intractable, that you have this huge number of schools. I mean, to Queensland colleague, I mean, you know, this is a huge system problem we've got. But it does seem to me that school-based assessment does something very different to exams, so one doesn't want to do away with it. But from the point of view of higher education, and higher education is an important incentive in itself for the school system, would it be possible, do you think, for the next 10 years at least to split the marks, at least higher education knows what a student got in the exam portion versus what they got in school-based? So there is a total mark, but from the point of view, because people are sceptical about the final result, partly because of school-based assessment. And Una Lucy, I know, has actually, you drew on their research, they are really perplexed about what to do about the problem.
Would you like to that is a very interesting notion. And I think for me, part of the problem is that with the school-based assessment being standardized against the examination results, part of the problem is that within the school-based assessment, the ranking is not necessarily reflected in the same ranking as happens in the exam. So you get this kind of mixed mark, which doesn't give you a clear sense one way or the other. The other issue is that with the statistical moderation, and this is where the lack of understanding sits with a large number of teachers, that they don't understand that you can give the child 70%. If the school as a whole only gets a mean of 40%, that 70% is unlikely to remain at 70%. So I think there's a mixture of understanding that sits within the school community that if there were two separate results, what would that school-based be? Would it be the standardized result? Would it be the raw result that came from the school, and so on? But I think the problem that higher education faces is bigger than just the results that come out of the schooling system. I mean, I think there's a whole range of other issues. Thank you.